Tunguska Blast Mystery from Mystery Diaries. On the morning of June 30, 1908, at 7:17 a.m., a remarkable phenomenon took place in the region to the north and northwest of Lake Baikal in Siberia, Russia, which is now famously known as the Tunguska incident. The so-called Tunguska event coincided with a large streaking fireball crossing the Siberian sky. It caused shockwaves as far away as Britain, and dust from the explosion lit up the night sky in its wake in Europe and even American regions. Despite the fact that a dozen explanations or more have been put forward to explain this event, its origin is still questionable. So what happened on that day? Because there are no live photographs of the blast, theories have abounded. A full century after the mysterious Tunguska explosion in Siberia leveled an area nearly the size of Tokyo, debate continues over what exactly caused it. On the morning of June 30, 1908, at around 7:17 a.m. local time, Russian villagers near the river Podkamennaya Tunguska in central Siberia reported a dark column of smoke and bright fiery flashes in a cloudless blue sky, followed by huge explosion. Eyewitnesses closer to the explosion reported that the source of the sound moved from the east to the north of them. The sounds were accompanied by a shock wave and tremors that knocked people off their feet and broke windows hundreds of kilometers away. People more than 40 miles or 64 kilometers away reported seeing a fireball as bright as the sun, followed by a searing heat wave and air burst. The explosion impact flattened some 60 million trees over an area of 800 square miles or 2,070 square kilometers in Siberian deep forest. Scientists calculated the Tunguska explosion could have been roughly as strong as 10 megatons to 20 megatons of TNT, which was several 100 times more powerful than the atom bomb dropped on Hiroshima, and impacts could be felt and seen till Eastern America also. The earth trembled. Windows smashed in the nearest town over 35 miles or 60 kilometers away. Residents there even felt heat from the blast, and some were blown off their feet. The massive explosion packed a wallop. The resulting seismic shockwave registered with sensitive barometers as far away as England and America. Dense clouds formed over the region at high altitudes, which reflected sunlight from beyond the horizon. Night skies glowed with that bright light across the Eurasia, and reports came in that people who lived as far away as Asia could read newspapers outdoors as late as midnight. Locally, hundreds of reindeers, the livelihood of local herders, were killed, but there was no direct evidence that any person perished in the blast. Fortunately, the area in which this massive explosion of airburst occurred was sparsely inhabited. The sky was split in two, and high above the forest the whole northern part of the sky appeared covered with fire. This Tunguska event is said to be the most powerful of its kind recorded in history. It is estimated that, in some places, the resulting shock wave was equivalent to an earthquake measuring 5.0 on the Richter magnitude scale. It also produced fluctuations in atmospheric pressure strong enough to be detected in Great Britain. Over the next few days, night skies in Asia and Europe were glowed. In the United States, the observatories observed a months-long decrease in atmospheric transparency due to an increase in suspended dust particles. The mysterious event's cause was not even investigated until 1927. When the explosion happened, nobody ventured to the site to investigate. The Tsarist Russian government at the time of the event did not look into the matter. The Tunguska region of Siberia is a remote place, with a dramatic climate. It has a long hostile winter and a very short summer, when the ground changes into a muddy uninhabitable swamp. This makes the area extremely hard to get to. In the intervening years, it was distracted by World War I and toppled Russian Tsar monarchy in the Russian Revolution of 1917, which also brought on the chaos of the Russian Civil War. The remote site of the explosion was first investigated from 1927 to 1930 in expeditions led by Soviet scientist Leonid Alexeyevich Kulik. Around the epicenter, Kulik found felled splintered trees lying radially for some 15 to 30 kilometer or 10 to 20 miles. Everything had been devastated and scorched, and very little was growing even 2 decades after the event. The epicenter was easy to pinpoint because the felled trees all pointed away from it. At that spot, investigators observed a marshy bog but no crater. The blast had been initially visible from about 800 kilometers or 500 miles away. Additional on-site investigations were performed by Soviet scientists in 1958 through 1961 and by an Italian-Russian expedition in 1999. At first, the locals were reluctant to tell Kulik about the event. They believed the blast was a visitation by the god Ogdi, who had cursed the area by smashing trees and killing animals. There was another belief that involved sinking of Titanic in 1912 as the subsequent event of wrath of the god after what happened in Tunguska in 1908. The people were in fear of supernatural thoughts of punishments and taking the control of mind due to these two incidents. Instead of a cause from above, in the last decade some researchers have suggested the Tunguska explosion actually came from below. Astrophysicists in Germany and others have suggested that an eruption of natural gas from kimberlite, a kind of volcanic rock best known for sometimes holding diamonds, could be to blame. It would have come from the molten Earth, some 3,000 kilometers or 1,864 miles deep. The natural gas would be stored as a fluid at that deep, and when it reached the surface it would become a gas and expand by a factor of 1,000 in volume, for a huge explosion. For this kind of view, pattern of the trees fell in and the chemical anomalies were considered, but never confirmed. Struck by the similarity of Tunguska and Hiroshima decades later, a science fiction writer wrote a story in which the Tunguska blast was the exploding nuclear power plant of a spaceship from Mars. A few Russian scientists took up the cause and claimed to find various bits of evidence which were never substantiated, for a civilized alien explanation. One writer even suggested an alien spaceship was trying to get to the nearby Lake Baikal for fresh water when it exploded just before landing. However, no remnants of any kind of spacecraft ever have been found in the area, undermining that theory for even the most strident believers. Another proposal was that a nuclear attack by UFOs caused the blast, but could not be confirmed ever. The man, famed inventor Nikola Tesla, who pioneered radio and modern alternating current AC electric power systems, was often seen as a mad scientist. One story alleges he test-fired a death ray on the evening of June 30, 1908, and once he found out about the Tunguska event, he dismantled the weapon, deeming it too dangerous to remain in existence. It's also been argued that Nikola Tesla caused the explosion when he tested his theorized death ray, a kind of particle beam tool that would be able to repel any kind of attack. Tesla talked about this invention frequently, envisioning it to be the end of all war. Could he have tried his invention in this remote area? Or perhaps he was working from his Wardenclyffe Tower in New York, trying to send a wireless signal to explorer in the North Pole, but hit the Tunguska region instead? This theory, too, has met with disdain, simply because there was never any evidence that Tesla had managed to create that kind of advanced technology. Whatever device he might have used would have required the 1908 New York power grid to operate, and could never generate the kind of energy released at the Tunguska event. Some suggested the Tunguska event could have been the result of matter and antimatter colliding. When this happens, the particles annihilate and emit intense bursts of energy. The annihilation of a chunk of antimatter from space does account for mineral debris the explosion left behind. The puzzling aspect was lack of any evidence, for example craters caused by fragments of a meteorite, on the surface. The crater-shaped Lake Baikal, some 5 miles from the epicenter, endorsed to be the missing link in the Tunguska mystery. It was not marked on Tsarist-era maps of Siberia, and the seismic measurements of its bottom indicated sediment had been building for around a century. They concluded that dense stony matter lies beneath the lake's floor and is the remnant of the exploding meteorite. The Italian theory based on the pattern of tree destruction is that two bodies entered the atmosphere. One exploded about 5 miles above ground, and the other hit the earth-forming Lake Baikal. Russian researchers have examined the sediment from the deepest part of the lake, some 50 meters below the surface. Researchers assessed the age by analyzing the bottom sediments, undertaking geochemical and biochemical analysis. The study indicates that the deepest sample they obtained is about 280 years old. This means the lake is probably even older, because the researchers did not manage to obtain samples from the very bottom of the sediment layer. Geologically, the lake appears young. But not young enough to be a crater lake caused by Tunguska, thus the theory remains a mystery. This also does not account for kind of mineral debris the explosion left behind, and there was no subsequent explosion as such a black hole, having tunneled through the Earth, would have shot back out through the surface of the Atlantic. Scientists hypothesized that a miniature black hole somehow crashed into Earth, causing an antimatter explosion, and shot out the other side. But no exit wound or similar damage has ever been found or reported, making that theory easy to dismiss as well. On the basis of historical records of significant noctilucent cloud development in the skies over Europe following the event, some scientists contend that a comet caused the explosion. Such clouds are thought to be the result of a sudden influx of ice crystals into the upper atmosphere, such as those that could have been triggered by the rapid vaporization of a comet. The long-standing theory regarding the cause of the event is a cosmic impact from an asteroid or comet. In the last decade, researchers have conjectured the event was triggered by an asteroid exploding in Earth's atmosphere, perhaps 50 to 100 meters wide, having a stony or carbonaceous composition and having 560,000 metric tons in mass, equal to more than 10 times that of the Titanic. It is estimated the asteroid entered Earth's atmosphere traveling at a speed of about 33,500 miles per hour. During its quick plunge, the space rock heated the air surrounding it to 44,500 degrees Fahrenheit. At a height of about 28,000 feet, the combination of pressure and heat caused the asteroid to fragment and annihilate itself, producing a fireball and releasing huge amount of energy. The majority of the asteroid was consumed in the explosion. Because the object exploded in the atmosphere high above Earth's surface, it created a fireball and blast wave, but no impact crater. The only likely remains of the object that have been found are a few small fragments, each less than a millimeter across. The radiant energy from such an explosion would be enough to ignite forests, but the subsequent blast wave would quickly overtake the fires and extinguish them. Thus, The Tunguska blast charred the forest but did not produce a sustained fire. A Tunguska-sized asteroid would enter Earth's atmosphere once every 300 years. The most popular theory is that this was an impact event, in which a meteorite, comet, or asteroid hit the Earth. The only problem, there's no crater in the Tunguska region, the only physical evidence of the explosion was the flattened trees. How could there be an impact from a meteor that leaves no evidence? In 2007, an Italian team suggested that a lake 5 miles or 8 kilometers north-northwest of the explosion's epicenter could be an impact crater. Lake Checo, as said, did not feature on any maps before the event. It is difficult to explain the origin of the lake in any other way. It would have formed after the impact, not from the main Tunguska body but of a fragment of the asteroid that was preserved by the explosion. It's believed that a large piece of asteroid lies below the bottom of the lake, buried in sediment. It would be very easy for Russians to get there and drill. Despite heavy criticism of the theory, there are hopes someone will scour the lake for remnants of meteoric origin, if any. Lake Checo is an impact crater is not so a popular idea. It is just another quasi theory. Any enigmatic objects at the bottom of this lake could be easily recovered with minimal efforts since the lake is not deep. In 2008, it was published a rebuttal to the theory, stating that unaffected mature trees were close to the lake, which would have been obliterated if a large piece of rock had fallen close by. The recent supercomputer simulations suggest the asteroid that caused the extensive damage was much smaller. The study of wood samples and sediment cores suggests that a comet or a meteorite was the likely culprit of the explosion. Say it would have been a factor of 3 or 4 times smaller in mass and perhaps 65 feet or 20 meters in diameter. As the asteroid exploded as it ran into Earth's atmosphere, it would have generated a supersonic jet air burst of expanding superheated gas. This fireball would have caused blast waves that were stronger at the surface than previously thought. The forest back then was unhealthy, according to foresters, so it would not have taken as much energy to blow down such trees. In addition, the winds from the explosion would naturally get amplified above ridgelines, making the explosion seem more powerful than it actually was. What researchers had thought to be an explosion between 10 and 20 megatons was more likely only 3 to 5 megatons. The scientists proposed that perhaps the nearby small Lake Checo was the crater, and that the asteroid was sitting at the bottom of it waiting to be discovered, but others say that their evidence isn't compelling enough to hold up to scrutiny. More than 100 years after the event, only sparse clues survive. No evidence whatsoever remains, as trees have recolonized the devastated area. On the ground, only a few stumps of trees killed by the explosion can be found, most already rotten away or buried in the swamp. What made the Tunguska event so dramatic was that it was an extremely rare case of what researchers call a megaton event, as the energy emitted was anywhere between 3 to 30 megatons of TNT. Many are convinced that it was an asteroid or a comet that was responsible for the blast. But very few traces of this large extraterrestrial object have ever been found, opening the way for more outlandish explanations for the explosion. But it's also true that scientists must shoulder some responsibility, because they took so long to analyze the explosion site. The researchers analyzed microscopic samples of rocks collected from the explosion site in 1978. The rock samples had a meteoric origin. Crucially, the fragments they analyzed were recovered from a layer of peat dating back to 1908. The remnants have a crystal structure almost like diamond. This particular mineral is known to form when a graphite-containing structure, such as a meteor, crashes into Earth. The study of samples from Tunguska, as well as research of many other authors, reveals meteorite origin of Tunguska event. We believe that nothing paranormal happened at Tunguska. As the object entered our atmosphere and broke apart, the intense heat resulted in shockwaves that were felt for hundreds of kilometers. When this airburst then hit the ground, it flattened all the trees in the vicinity. Tunguska remains an astronomical cold case, but its mystery is inspiring modern-day investigators to mitigate future threats. But it is not all bad news. The probability of that happening is extremely small, especially given the huge surface area of Earth that is covered in water majorly. When a Tunguska-type event happens again, the overwhelming probability is that it will happen nowhere near human population. Thank you guys, and see you in the next video.